Okay, good. The story of Ghent. We were in the Middle Ages, we were a very important city. In the 14th century, we were almost the most important city of Western Europe. But in the 20th and 21st century, we were a city like many others. In the case of mobility, we had many traffic jams. There was lots of noise, unsafety for pedestrians and cyclists, like many other cities in Europe. So what you see is a picture of the 80s, but since then it changed a bit. So I became a deputy mayor in 2013, a deputy mayor for mobility and public works. And what we want to do was to make a city for people. It's very, very easy. That's, I think, something that every politician likes to do, of aims to do. So to make a city for people. Why? To increase livability, to increase safety, to increase accessibility. So the question was, how should we do it? And in 2013 and 2014, I visited Copenhagen, I visited Utrecht and Groningen, and what I saw was marvelous. The quality level of their infrastructure for cyclists and for pedestrians was amazing. That's what I wanted to have in Ghent. So, but that was a problem, because if I wanted to have the same level of quality in infrastructure, I needed a huge budget, and I needed time. So to realize what Copenhagen did, what Utrecht did, what Amsterdam did, what Groningen did, it should cost me 20, 30 years. So that was not the way. Infrastructure is important, but that was not the way that we did it. We took a shortcut to have the same results, to have space for pedestrians, space for cyclists, to have better livability, to have more safety. We took a shortcut by the circulation plan. And if you expect something very spectacular, no, it isn't. It's very, very simple. What we did, what we saw before we implemented the circulation plan, was that in rush hour, in the morning, in the evening, a lot of car traffic in the city center was through traffic that needn't to be there. So 11% of all cars in rush hour was pure transit traffic. Through traffic. 28% was semi-transit traffic, avoiding parts of the city ring road, the beltway, and only 51% was destination traffic. 9% was internal traffic in the neighborhoods. So you know people who use their car to drive 500 meters further. So 9%. So the conclusion was very easy. There is too much motorist traffic in the city center, traffic that needn't to be there. So, and that's what we did, not spectacular. This is the city center. What you see is the diameter is about 3 kilometers. The circumference of the ring road is about 14 kilometers. So what we did is, in the middle, we had a small car-free zone, car-free area. We enlarged it. That's what you see in purple. And then we have six zones around it in different colors, as you see. And it's very easy for pedestrians, for cyclists, for public transport, for taxis. Nothing changed, nothing. But for car drivers, something changed. If they wanted to go from one zone to another, it was the only way was to use the ring road. They had access to the zones via the ring road. There is no exchange of car traffic between the zones. So that meant no more going through traffic in the city. That's very easy. It's as simple as this. So how did we prevent traffic going through? By blocks, bollards, paint, by number plate recognition cameras, by plants, by benches, and so on, and so on. We used also the rivers in the city of Ghent, and that's the only thing we did. All those measures, we prepared them in about 2.5 years, from October 2014 till April 2017, but we changed everything in one weekend. So before the weekend, the Friday, everything was as it was, and in the Monday, everything was changed. So not spectacular at all. The results. I think the results were spectacular for me. We have an increased number of cyclists. In 2012, we had the share of cyclists in all trips in Ghent, all the trips of the Ghentians, was 22%. In 2018, the year after the circulation plan, it was 35%. 35%. So it means that there's an increase of from 22% till 35%. We have an increased number of public transport users. We had after the circulation plan, we had about 10-12%, an increase of 10-12% of public transport users. We have a bit of a surprise. We have a decreased travel time for cars within the city center, because there were no traffic jams anymore in the city center. That was amazing. On the ring road, there were still some traffic jams, not so many as we expected, and about the same as before. But in the city center, there were no traffic jams anymore. We have less transit traffic, of course, because it is impossible to drive through the city. We have less accidents. In 1 year, we had a decrease of 35% of accidents, 35%. So you can say Ghent became safer. We have an improved air quality, NOx minus 18%. So also the air quality was better. This is the modal split, 2012-2018, what I said. From 2012, 55% car driving, the share of car driving, 55%. In 2018, 39%. In 2019, we reached the results of what we wanted to have in 2030. So also that was a surprise for us. What is important is that the circulation plan is neither the beginning nor the end. We had a cycling plan in 1995. That was the beginning of the cycling movement, where cycle paths were realized, were built, the first cycling bridge, and so on. We had the first small circulation plan in 97. Not so immense or not so important for mobility, but important in the minds of people, because they already had a circulation plan. They were used to have a circulation plan. Then we had a parking plan in 2016, where the parking fee was increased. A serious increase, because before that, before the parking plan, park was almost free in Ghent. Then in 2017, we had the circulation plan, which I'm telling about. And then in 2019, since 2019 till 2025, we have mobility plans for the outskirts, for the neighborhoods around the center. So we have seven mobility plans for the outskirts, and the goals are just the same as the big circulation plan of 2017, an increased livability and safety with a decrease of going through traffic, focus on active modes, intense participation process. What we are doing now is to build infrastructure, because I started my presentation with the fact that to build infrastructure, you need a budget, you need time, and we took a shortcut. We gave space to pedestrians and cyclists and public transport, but it's also important that there is a second policy line, that you pin your mobility, your sustainable mobility, by infrastructure. So now we are busy with building cycling passages, highways, cycling bridges, cycling streets, and so on. So that's very important. It's not only a circulation plan, but there is also the policy of building infrastructure, cycling infrastructure, infrastructure for pedestrians. What you see in right below, that's the living streets. It's very important. That's something I started in 2013, and that's an experiment where we give the street to the people who live, the residents, people who live there, and they can design the streets as they wish for 2 months or for 3 months, temporarily. So the only condition there is that there should be no cars anymore in the street. So what is important? 2 things. What we see is that the design of the residence is totally different from the design of our engineers. If the residents design their streets themselves, the street is totally different from the design of our engineers. So that's very important. We learn something about how people look at their own street. Second thing that is important in the living streets is that people are becoming used to streets with no cars. It's something that they learn. Even the people who are who oppose car-free cities, car-free streets, are willing to have this experiment, because it's only 2 months. But in those 2 months, they learn how a car-free street can be so pleasant for all the residents. So we are building infrastructure. You see Copenhagen, beware. Public transport, that's very, very important. We have a system for public transport is free for kids. We have night buses. We pay with the city. We pay free shuttles to the park and rides and so on. But what is important, if you look at the circulation plan, is that in the period before the implementation of the circulation plan, the opponents always said to me that first, better the alternatives, and the moment the alternatives are better, you can start with your circulation plan. That's not correct, because what happened was, the moment we implemented the circulation plan, we got so many space also for public transport that the alternative, the public transport, got better. It got more reliable. It was faster. It was better. So it's not better the alternatives and then start the circulation plan. It's start the circulation plan and the alternatives get better. And that's very important. Then what we also do is to work on cycling culture. What you see is on the left on the top is the Cycling Embassy of Ghent. It's an organization we started, and the only purpose is that they have to better the life of the cyclists in the city. They have actions where they support on all different manners the cyclists in the city. So it's also it's not only circulation plan, it's not only infrastructure, it's also to build a cycling culture in the city. Another thing we do, and it's something totally different, but it's also important for the atmosphere, for what people feel in the city. It's replace always 15% of the paved roads with greenery and trees. Something we do for climate and also for livability, but it shows the way we look at the city. And this is the most important slide. This is why we did what we did. You see the same square. On the left, top left, it's the square before the circulation plan. A parking. What you see is on the right, in front, is the same square now. It's a park, it's a place where many people in Ghent come now. Before, no one came there, only the car drivers. Now it's a place for the people of Ghent, for the residents. And I think this shows everything. This is why we did what we did. So this was in short what we did in Ghent. It was not so easy as it looks now. This presentation was short, 20 minutes, but the period before the implementation of the circulation plan was very hard. I presented the first sketch of the circulation plan in October 2014, and in the 2.5 years between October 2014 and April 2017, there were many debates. It was a period where I was almost never at home. Every evening I was somewhere in a debate or a session, information session. And it was especially hard because not for the hard work, but it was a very rough debate in Ghent. The opponents were very destructive, and I've got some death threats. I've got police surveillance for about 5-6 weeks because they were afraid that something should happen to me because of those death threats. In fact, it was that was very hard. But What was important is that the moment we started, the 3rd of April 2017, it was very strange. I had a period of 2.5 years of rough debate, of opposition, of death threats. And then the first day, the 3rd of April, I've got in the city, everything was changed. I was a bit, of course, I was a bit nervous on that on that day, the 3rd of April. But everything went smoothly. There were no real problems. And what was very strange is that after those 2.5 years of rough debate, I came in the streets and almost everyone I saw said, congratulations, very good, we are so pleased, and so on. So what is important, why do I tell this? What is important is that if you want to reach something, if you want to implement something, those who oppose it are always very noisy. But it's important to know that there is a silent majority, and in Ghent was a silent majority who was in favor of the circulation plan, who is very silent because they trusted in what we did. And if I should have regarded only the opposition, it should have been too hard to implement too difficult to implement the circulation plan. But it's very important to know that there are also people who are in favor, who are silent, but they are in favor, and that's important. Okay. Maybe there are questions. No, there aren't.
I was going to suggest, so we've got people online and people in the room. So we'll take questions from both. And while we're just gathering the questions, I was just going to jump in and ask Philippe if you could tell us how you make it accessible for people with disabilities, because this is something we're grappling with in York at the moment. Yeah. And then I'm going to gather questions from online and in the room.
Yeah. We have a, first of all, if you look at the, and I will go to there. Oh, moment. If you look to the circulation plan, all those 6 zones are accessible with cars. So there's in those 6 zones, there's no street that isn't accessible with the car. Only car drivers have to use another take another road than before, but everything is accessible. Only in the car-free zone in the middle, there is a system of permits, but we have people with disabilities can be brought by family or by friends and so into the car-free area. We have a special permit for that. We have also a special service that transports people with disabilities. And we also have a system of taxi vouchers for people in transport poverty. So we try to have an alternative for people with disabilities. Is that an answer to your question?
I think so, yes, thank you. Following on from that, we have a question. How did you resist the opposition of car drivers? And on the same lines, how did you convince politicians not to pander to car drivers?
It's very important that the politicians who are in the lead of this of a circulation plan like this believe in what they are, they should believe in what they are doing. Because how can you resist the opposition of car drivers. Some are reasonable, and then it's a question of arguments. But many people, when it comes to mobility, are very emotional. And it's very difficult to take their concerns away. That's very difficult, because they are concerned about what will happen, and you can't guarantee them 100% that everything will be fine. You can't guarantee that, because it's very complex. So the only thing you can do is to have an open mind, to really listen to their concerns, and to try to translate it in your policy, and to find solutions. But it's normal that people are concerned, and the only thing that they believe is the moment it has changed, and the moment they see that you can come everywhere with your car, only the true traffic is away. So it's a question of to be sure that you believe in what you stand for. It's a question of to be open for what people are concerned about, and to talk and to keep talking.
So a question here, we've got about 30 people in the room, and I think over 100 online, so we're just balancing it out. But in the room, we've got a lot of people who are interested to know about how retailers and businesses felt both before you implemented your plan and after the plan, and what impact had on business. Has it helped business? Has it changed the kind of businesses you have in Ghent?
Yeah. In the opposition for the circulation, against the circulation plan, you had the car drivers, but you had also the shop owners. And that's normal, because it's about their business, and they are concerned about the future of their business. That's normal. What we saw is that if you look at the vacancy of shops in Ghent, you see that we do it quite well. We have the same problems as other cities in Flanders, in Belgium. There's no increase of vacancy that is stronger than in other cities. So it's about the same. But what is important that is that there are some shops and some enterprises. It's for some shops and some enterprises, it's more difficult than for others. And you see that the older shops, the shops of tradition with an what older public, that are the shops that that it's difficult for difficult for them. Younger shops, it's not such a problem. You see a transformation in the city, because in fact the urban the city economy has changed, because the logic of city economics changed, because what is important, what became important in these days, where you can buy everything on your laptop. You don't need a shop because you have a laptop. E-commerce is everywhere. So what is important now in city economics is the experience. you don't come anymore to the city because you have to, you need something special, or you need to buy something special, but you come for the experience to walk in a pleasant city where it's quiet, where there are no cars everywhere, where you have beautiful squares and beautiful streets and historical buildings. And that's what changed, the experience. City economics is now about experience. And also that we bettered the experience of walking in Ghent by the circulation plan. So what we see in city economics is that there is a transformation of the older shops are disappearing, but there are coming new shops, more cafes, more restaurants. And so there's a transformation, but I said it already, the vacancy is about the same as it was before the circulation plan. Is that an answer?
Yes, thank you.
It's very important. It's very important to look at other cities. If I in the debates, if I told, don't worry, everything will be fine and so on, it made not so much impression on the shop owners. But if you go with a group of shop owners to a city like Utrecht, or a city like Copenhagen, they see that that it's possible to have a pleasant city, a city that is good for pedestrians, cyclists, and so on. And although to be a vibrant city. So the examples are very, very important. So I hope that also Ghent can be an example for other cities.
We have a question from online. If you could do it again, what is the biggest mistake that you would avoid?
The biggest mistake was that it was only a mobility project. I was the deputy mayor for mobility. I'm still deputy mayor for mobility, but everyone was uncertain. Also, my colleagues, my fellow deputy mayors, everyone was uncertain. It was, and because of that uncertainty, it was my project. It was a mobility project. But if you want to do it perfect, it should also be an economic, a cultural, a social project as well. And it's a question to you have to see the opportunities and the threats also for city economics. And that was the mistake we did. It was only a mobility project. And if I should restart, it should be a project of economics, culture, and so on. That is the biggest mistake we did.
So a question from in the room here. People are wondering what kind of consultations you did with people in the city, with businesses and residents. How much of you talked about having this conversation with people, but what kind of consultation did you do?
Well, different kinds. We had information sessions, just give information. We had debates. We had brainstorms about what to do when the circulation plan was implemented. We had also some people who guided the shop owners individually, because of the moment and the guidance was to give them ideas what they should do the moment the circulation plan was implemented. So we had different kinds of meetings. Is that an answer to your question?
Yeah, I think so. I'm wondering if you engaged stakeholders to get their opinions, and did you then feed that into your model?
Sorry, I can't understand it.
Sorry, did you engage stakeholders and then feed that? Did you make changes to the plans based upon what you heard from people?
Yeah, yes, we did. But I said I told you that I was almost 2.5 years away from home. Every evening, debates, information sessions, and so on and so on. And what we did on in a certain period was to bring groups of people together, groups of residents, but also groups of shop owners and entrepreneurs. And they looked in group to the cards, the maps of the circulation plan. And they gave me IDs, and they showed us the mistakes that were in the circulation plan. And so we changed a lot of things. There were sometimes there were very good ideas, sometimes there were also bad ideas, but we tried to evaluate every to judge every ID, and if it was good, the circulation plan could also only get better. So I think that was an important way of working, because it's very important to that people trust what you are doing. And if they see that you their ID is taken serious, that's important to for their trust.
We have a question about car ownership in Ghent, numbers and percentage, I guess, before and after, if it changed.
What we see is that in the center of the city, only 50% of the families has a car. And that's that is because also because of a policy to support people that don't have a car. We can support them in our cycling policy, with our public transport policy, but also with car sharing. Car sharing is very important in Ghent. The moment I became a deputy mayor, I had in Ghent about 3,000, 4,000 residents who were a member of a car sharing organization. Now it's about 16,000. So that's very important. What we see is that there's a status quo in the people who have a car, who own a car. But if you look at the number of cars per 1,000 residents, you see a slight, a certain decrease. Not very strong, but there is a decrease, and that's totally different from what is happening in Flanders, where we can see every year an increase in car ownership. In Ghent, it's status quo and a bit decrease.
Following on from that, here in York, our council is very dependent on income from car parking and from residents' parking permits. And we're wondering if in Ghent, how did you rebalance the economy when you can't any longer get so much money from car parking and residents' parking permits and so on?
Yes, but we have still. Lots of income of car parking, but the structure has changed, because in 2014-15 car parking was very very cheap. And what we did is in 2016, the parking plan, we increased the what people had to pay for to park in the city. So we had more income from parking. We had fewer people who parked their car, but we had more income from parking. And it meant that the budget, the result was a budget for mobility we used to develop, to implement many things for cyclists, for car sharing, and so on. So to give you an idea, I don't know what this parked car costs in York, but in the city center, you have to pay here in Ghent for 3 hours, you have to pay 10 euros. What is it in York?
About,
I guess it would be similar,
3 hours. Yeah. How many? How much? Well, so it's £2.60 an hour. £3 an hour.
Yeah, but it's important that before 2016 in Ghent, it was about, for 3 hours, it was about 3 euros, something like that. And now it's 10 euro. Yeah. So it's also the maximum in the center. It's the maximum you can park, 3 hours. On street is the maximum. Not if you are off street parked, but it changed. The increase was rather strong. Yeah. There was also much opposition for our parking plan.
We have a question from online, which we're very interested in. What was the budget for your cycle ambassadors?
For our cycling embassy.
Oh, yes, your cycling embassy.
For the moment, it should be about, I think, €1 million a year, something like that.
Nice.
Is it enough for you?
We can make it work.
Yeah, but it's so important that if you want to have cyclists in a city, you have to look at them as the most important road users there are. I was used in Ghent 20 years ago. I was used in Ghent that I was, as a cyclist, something in the margin. I had no space, I had no safety, I had no comfort. So if you want to have people, to get people on a bicycle, they should feel, not only by the fact, but they should feel that they are important. And that's what we try to do every day, to show them that they are important. So, for example, what we do with the cycling embassy is almost every 5 weeks, every 2 months, there's an action where cycling embassy goes to the important cycling routes, important cycling paths. They have a stand there, and if people want to have air in their tires, they get, they give it, they want to have grease on their cycling chain. I don't know if my words are correct, but they give it. So these are our air and grease actions. That doesn't cost much, but it's important to show cyclists you are important. And if people feel important, they keep cycling.
Oh, I love that. Great.
We've got a question here that I think comes from one of our local councillors asking, do you provide consultancy services to other cities?
I give presentations as today, but that's very important that I have been inspired by Copenhagen, Utrecht, Groningen, by Bordeaux, other cities. And if cities wanted to know what we are doing in Ghent, or what we have done in Ghent and still are doing, they are always welcome in our city. If you want to come, Mr. or Mrs. Councillor, if you want to come to Ghent, please be welcome. I will guide you in Ghent. I give this presentation. If you invite me to York, I should be pleased to come to York. But it's very important that cities inspire other cities. I have been inspired. I like to inspire other cities.
I'll take you up on that.
And perhaps related, what was the best thing you did to persuade your sceptical council colleagues to take your plans forward?
The best thing was that we were in 2000 in the period 2013-2018. We had a coalition. I'm from the Green Party, but we had a coalition with the Social Democrats, let's say the Labour Party of Ghent, and the Liberal Party in Ghent. And I had in the other two parties, I had two colleagues I trusted very much. And I worked together very strong with those two other colleagues. And when I showed them what my problems were with the circulation plan, to design the circulation plan, they took it as their own problem. And by that, those two people were the really people who supported me. The other colleagues did a bit less, but those two supported me. So it's important that you have some people, some colleagues you can trust in other parties than your own party.
A question from online again. Has Ghent become more desirable to live and work in, do you think? And has it led to an increase in house prices that reflect that?
an increase in?
House prices to reflect this desire.
Yeah, that's a very difficult one. I think that Ghent is a very pleasant city with a high level of quality of life is better, and so on. It's a good city to live in, but a huge problem is gentrification, because estate prices, housing prices are increasing also. So what we did in this period in 2019 till 2025 is we invest about 90 million euro in housing here in Ghent to make it possible for people to buy a house, to rent a house, and that's one of the most important problems with the circulation plan. You better quality of life, you better livability. But that reflects that is being reflected in housing prices, and that's gentrification, and that's really really a problem. Another thing about our city, what you see also is that it's a good city. The quality of life is very good. It's a pleasant city. The experience of the city is very good. And what you see, we have also a university. Ghent has 260,000 inhabitants, but we have also 80,000 students in our city. We have a university with 80,000 university and some other colleges, and we have about 80,000 students. What you see is that many of those students stay in Ghent. So the result is a young population, also a vibrant city. but also economically it's very important. We have very many spin-offs of the university. We have the largest number of startups in the whole of Belgium. So we had we have many startups. We have also economically we are vibrant. So that's important. And so that's also that is a factor in what I said about housing prices and gentrification.
What were the noisy, who were the noisiest objectors? Individuals, companies, or organized groups?
The noisiest. No, not the companies. People who wanted to keep driving with their car everywhere, and they wanted that's all. It's the emotional ones, people who are. You know, what is very important is there's a generation, people who are now more than 70, yeah? That's a generation, that was the first generation that was that had the possibility to buy a car. If I look to my parents, they are 90. They were the first generation who could buy a car. And also people who are 80, 70, for them that's very important. The car was the symbol of freedom, of social mobility also. And they were at the moment they were 20, they were 20 years old, they bought a car, and so that was social mobility. We are in progress. We are it was for them it was a sign of their of a good life and a career and so on. And then they are 70, 80 and so on. And there comes a town council and a deputy mayor who says, a car, it's not always fantastic. So let's change the system, the mobility system. Oh, and that was very emotional, because once their car was a sign of success, and now it was a sign of conservatism. So that was very emotional. And those people who were very emotional were very noisy. I don't know if my answer was the right answer to your question, but I tried, in fact.
Oh, it's fascinating, really interesting.
I think we've had a lot of questions about cars, because here in York, we are perhaps quite car dependent. To the extent where there are three multi-storey car parks being planned to be built. And so a lot of people are asking about how you kind of turned around that car dependency. Obviously doing the circulation plan turned it around, but what did you do about people still need to store the car that they have on the street? So how do you create space and things like this?
That's a difficult one, because it's an evolution that goes rather slowly, because I know many people who are cyclists every day to their work, to their friends, to everything they do, but they have a car. Why do they have a car? Because people are used to have a car, and it's very difficult to have another step, the step of I don't need a car, I don't want it, and that's very very difficult, because people are so used to own their car even if they don't use it. And There's, in fact, there's only one way, but that's difficult for politicians. In fact, there's only one way to, no, that's not true. One way is not true, but a very important way to get out of that scheme of car dependency is the parking space. If parking is difficult, people start to think about, should I have a car or shouldn't I? And so the parking policy is crucial to get a lower car dependency. That's one, but that's the severe line. The good line is to have a policy on car sharing. So I'm a deputy mayor. I don't have a car. I have to be sometimes in Brussels, on to Antwerp, and so on, even abroad. But I don't have a car. So, but in the neighbor, I live in the center of the city. In our center, at the city of in the city center, so the area you can see, there are car sharing stations about approximately every 300 meters. So every time I need a car, and sometimes that's the case, I have a car. I can get a car by the car sharing organization. So that's the good line. So car sharing, and the severe line is the parking pressure, the parking space. Okay.
Thank you. So we're going to ask you one final question, which it looks like you're sitting, your background has got what looks like a flyover, and we want to know, what is it that you're sitting underneath?
No, it's no flyover. Oh, it's a flyover, but it's a cycling bridge.
Right.
It's the last, it's not, I think it's about 1 year. It's not yet a year that it opened. It's a new cycling bridge. So the Louisa Davé bridge. Louisa Davé, the name of the bridge, Louisa Davé, was someone in the First World War who spied for the Allies, for the British and for the French. She lived in Ghent. Ghent was occupied by the Germans, and so she spied for the British and for the French. She gave the sign. She warned the British for the first gas attack in Flanders, because her father had a factory in textile, and he heard about the rumors about the gas attack, and we named it after her. She was a real hero, a Belgian hero. But it's important that also cycling bridges have good names.
Brilliant. What a great way to end it. Thank you so much.
So another thing for the councillor who is there in the audience, no one asked me about the price of our circulation plan. And the price is amazing. The cycling bridge, you see, costed about 4 million euro. That's only one cycling bridge. The circulation plan costed 5 million euro. So that's rather cheap. So it's simple, it's cheap, and you can implement it fast. So what are you waiting for?